wonderful chemistry webinar series of Indrashil University. Let me introduce our panelists. We have honorable chief guest, Dr. Professor Lakshmikanta Manapalli. Under her supervision, actually I done my postdoctoral study. Welcome, madam, for our Indrashil University virtual platform. We have with us our provost, Dr. J.S. Yadav, sir. Welcome, sir, for our webinar series. We have Mr. Abhinand Pandya, project director. Welcome, sir, for our university website webinar series. I also welcome our Dean, ma'am, Bharti Dave, Dean SOS. Also welcome to Dean SOE, Dr. Amish Vyas, sir. We have with me our colleagues, Dr. Polmi Sen Gupta and Dr. Jay Prakash Reddy. With this, first of all, I would like to invite our provost for giving his opening remarks. Sir, please welcome and please give your opening remarks.
Just 1 minute. Webinar, and I also Lakshmi Kanta, whenever we ask her to do anything, she will always say yes sir, nothing else. And when I ask her to give webinar, I heard that webinar 2 days back, so I asked her same thing you give here in IU, and she didn't think even, she said yes sir. Only time was the issue, because Monday onwards, she is a very busy person, you may not be knowing. Many DST meeting, many ministry meeting, SIR meeting, she is everywhere there. I don't know, I have lost count. When I was director at that time also, she was at least in 15 committee. After retirement, I'm sure she might have got another 15, so maybe 30 committee. DST, all women scientists or industrial scientists, whatever you, for women scientists, she was chairing, for giving fellowship, giving grant and all those things for several years. And she had been helping all the women in India in some form or other. In many cases, if the project is not proper, even she has advised them to write properly, sanction money and said, go ahead. The she so much has helped, Pan India program of women scientists. So that is done. And, I know her ever since I joined IICT, that was in 86. And I think she has already joined in 1984, right?
Yes, sir.
She had joined. And she was really married to lab only. Whenever you go, it is Saturday, Sunday. Normally, I also used to stay till late, sometime 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock in the night. Only light will see in her lab. See, it will be there. So that is the way she was working. And once, Paul Muthuswamy, you can say catalysis man of India, we just crossed each other in our IICT came. Then he's asking her, are you married to IICT? So that is the way she had worked throughout her. Like if you see her things, very rare to find that who has done first class basic work, then also applied that to industry. And only thing is, it takes time. When she was like a director of IICT, the most of the project now are being implemented. So, but she feels happy because it was all done by her. That is one. Second is, she is the first lady in CSIR system who became director of, not just a lab, but director of a star lab, IST, Indian Institute of Chemical Technology. Only I wish you would have got more time the most of the project was she conceived would have been commercialized during her time. So that, but no, doesn't matter, it was all that commercialized and it is getting commercialized. So with this word, and she is a very good host, by the way. You know, IACT, when I'm not there, she will host all my guests, including my wife. So we had, they have been very close friends like that for several years. So her family, our family, they have been good. And so only thing I can say that, you know, she is always, whatever in her power, always try to help, never say no. So I can say that, you know, all our human scientists should take advantage of that. She will definitely help all of you. Okay, Lakshmi, I think I said everything. Anything left?
nothing.
Huh?
Nothing left.
Nothing left. Okay. Chalo. Okay, who is going
Thank
to?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your opening remarks. I would like to invite our Abhinand sir for his special remarks of our webinar series. Abhinand sir.
First of all, madam, welcome to Indrashil University. You are an ocean for us. It is going to be a big thing for us, students like us. So whatever drops you can send it to us, it is going to be big thing for us. And today at this platform, I can see two great stars, you know, North Stars in field of chemistry. And we are blessed to have you at this session. And we hope that we once will be able to see you at our campus and host you over there for an interactive session with our kids. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Abhinand sir. Here, I would like to invite our Dean, Professor Bharti Madam, for giving a brief introduction of our university. Bharti Madam, please.
So on behalf of Indrashil University, I welcome you virtually, madam. Just to give you a profile of our university in very brief, as to what how was our university established, what we are doing at our university. Next slide, please. So Indrashil University, you can say they have a source of inspiration, as you might be knowing, is Sri Indravardhan Bhai Modi, who was the founder chairman of our university, and who is known as the medicine man of India, a core nationalist at heart. And he believed that medicine should be affordable and should reach to the poorest of the poor of the country. And that is how Cadila Pharmaceuticals still works on this. So this Indrashil University was established as a philanthropic initiative of our beloved Chancellor, Dr. Rajiv Bhai Modi, in loving memory of his parents, Sri Indravardhan Bhai Ambalal Modi and Srimati Sheila Ben Modi, who had laid the foundation stone of Cadila Pharmaceuticals in 1951. If I tell you the journey of the success of our university, of Cadila Pharmaceuticals, so Cadila Pharmaceuticals, when it was initiated in 1951, it was just in one small called as Hasot in Bharuch district. So initially it just started in one small room, and you know, Indravardhan Bhai used to move around on a bicycle. He was riding 35 to 40 kilometers per day, used to market and sell his product on a bicycle. His wife, Srimati Sheila Ben Modi, was the first employee of Cadila Pharmaceuticals Limited. And in fact, she was the one who has always inspired Indravardhan Bhai Modi to first indigenously manufacture the first gripe water of our country. And you know, which has brought smiles to the millions of parents of our country. And so to honor the legacy of care and compassion, the university's governing body and Dr. Rajiv Modi are determined to holistically transform and develop this university into a hallmark of global excellence, both in terms of academics, in terms of research, and now in terms of innovation. Next slide, please. So if you see to the success of milestones of our university, as I said, it was established in 1951, previous in Cadila Pharmaceuticals. It has now over 10,000 employees and its presence is in 90 plus countries. So Cadila Pharmaceuticals started its education initiative in 2016 by establishing Sri Saraswati Education Sansthan. And in 2018, it was Indrashil University, which was established as the first life sciences university of our country. And seeing to the success of our university, it was in 2019 that the government of India supported us with Atal Incubation Center, with its flagship program to encourage youth of our country, youth of Gujarat, to initiate startup and become future entrepreneurs of our country. in 2019-20, again, government of Gujarat supported us with Indrashil Innovative Foundation, with its student startup and innovation policy. Again, in this year, 2021, the Industries Commissionerate of Gujarat has supported us as a nodal center for the startup and entrepreneurship. Next slide, please. So, as you must be knowing, the mentor of a university, the source of success behind this university is Dr. G.S. Yadav, provost of a university, mentor and director of a university, one of the best known organic chemists of our country, former director of IICT Hyderabad, who has, to his credit, several accolades of national level, Ashanti Swarup Bhatnagar Fellow, J.C. Bose National Fellow, and many more. So plus 150 patents, more than 1,500 publications, 250 plus PhD students. Still we have 11 students working with him, around 30,000 citations to his credit. Next slide, please. So at Indrashil University, what we offer is academic excellence, both in terms of teaching, in terms of research, in terms of innovation. As it is supported by Cadila Pharmaceuticals, we provide enough of industrial exposure to the students in terms of internship, in terms of placement in the industries. We focus on overall development of the students, be it curricular, co-curricular, extracurricular, and we have tried to achieve global academic standards. Next. So under this umbrella of Indrashil University, we have School of Engineering, School of Science. Engineering offers BTech in Computer Science and Engineering, Mechanical Engineering, Chemical and Biochemical Engineering. BS School of Science offers BSc Honors in Chemistry, BSc Honors in Biosciences. Ours is the first university to offer honors degree at an undergraduate level. MSc in Chemistry, MSc in Animal Biology, MSc in Microbiology, and PhD programs under both the schools. We have international collaborations with Sacred Heart University, USA, Tuskegee University, USA, and Newcastle University, Australia. At present, it is with Computer Science and Engineering, where the students would be studying for 3 years at a university, 1 year at their university, and they would be earning dual degrees, both from Indrashil as well as foreign universities. Next slide. So as we have Dr. G.S. Yadav as our mentor, you might be knowing we have sophisticated state-of-the-art infrastructure laboratory facilities, both in chemistry, biology, and in engineering. So one of the highly sophisticated equipment that we have procured at present is nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. And ours is the first university in Gujarat to have NMR, which is available both to PG students as well as to PhD students. Next slide, please. So as our university is linked to industries, we have collaborations with a number of industries as Cadila Pharmaceuticals, CII, Karnavati Engineering, National Chemical Laboratory, Pune. We have collaboration with IICT. Recently, 22 of our students, MSc students, were for their internship to IICT Hyderabad. We have collaboration with NCL Pune. We have collaboration with CSM, CRI Bhavnagar, Apollo Hospitals, Jackson, Tata Consultancy Services, etc. Next slide, please. So as I've said, at the Indrashil University, we have Atal Incubation Center, we have Indrashil Innovative Foundation, and the third to add, next slide please, is a nodal agency for students to initiate their startups. So in these all three platforms, what we offer is world-class R&D laboratories, which we have, we provide dedicated office and laboratory space. We provide a provision of rupees 50 lakh as kickstart support and rupees 2 crores as seed fund support. Handholding by renowned mentors, which may be from industries, government departments, R&D labs, both public as well as private, and 360 degree overall support if they wish to take their startup to a sustainable business. Next. So this was all about our university in very brief. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam, for introducing our university. Here I would like to invite our Polvi madam for giving introduction of our Lakshmi Kantam, madam. Over to you, Polvi madam.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. I feel immensely fortunate introducing Professor M. Lakshmi Kantam to today's audience. Professor Lakshmi Kantam was the former director of CSIR Institute of Chemical Technology, Hyderabad. She is also an honorary professor at the University of Newcastle, Australia, and an adjunct professor at RMIT University, Melbourne. Apart from managing various academic and leadership positions for various organizations, Professor Kantam is also the non-executive independent director at Godavari Biorefineries Limited, Indoamines Limited, and Vinati Organics Limited. Professor Kantam's scientific journey started with her PhD degree from Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra, under the guidance of Professor V. Yati Rajam in 1982. She joined as a scientist B in Indian Institute of Chemical Technology, Hyderabad in the year 1984. Later, she became the director of the same institute. She has guided around 40 PhD students. The admirable scientist has published 347 research papers in reputed peer-reviewed journals with citations of around 16,000. She has further authored and edited 5 books. The brilliant scientific mind has been granted 52 patents for her innovations. Her present industry collaborations include companies such as GBL, VOL, Hikal Remilet, Indoamines Limited, Jubilant Rallies, Kesar Petroproducts Limited, GACL, Marvel Drugs, Prazol, Mangalam Organics, etc. She is associated with various government organizations, including the Department of Atomic Energy, Department of Science and Technology, High Energy Material Research Laboratory, Pune, DRDO, IIT Hyderabad, GAIL, etc., to name a few. Professor Kantam's contributions are recognized with numerous honors and awards. She has been awarded ICCDM Trivedi Lifetime Achievement Award in 2019, Devang Mehta Rational Education Award, Women in Education Award in 2017, Asian Paints Padma Vibhushan, Dr. R.A. Mashalkar Medal, and ChemCon Distinguished Speaker Award for Leadership in Science, Technology, and Education, ChemCon in 2016, J.C. Bose Fellowship by SORB DST in 2015, Lifetime Achievement Award by Indian Chemical Society in 2011. She is further honored as a fellow of the World Academy of Sciences, Indian National Science Academy, the Royal Society of Chemistry, UK, National Academy of Sciences, India. The spirited woman also performs her scholarly duties as the editor board member at Chemical Records, Wheely, VCH, and Journal of Chemical Sciences, Springer Publishers, and the associate editors. Catalysis in Green Chemistry and Engineering, Bagel House. With no further ado, I, on behalf of Indrashil University, would like to welcome you, madam, to your lecture, Design and Development of Homogeneous or Heterogeneous Catalysis for Sustainable Chemical Industry. Madam, the floor is all yours. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank you to Professor Yadav, and who has invited me to give this lecture. And also my thanks to Bharati and Rajesh and Paulomi about the introduction about me. And as you know that my role model is Professor Yadav. Dr. Yadav is my role model. And also Indrashil University is blessed to have Dr. Yadav with you. So if given a chance, I will also come to Indrashil University later, yeah? Professor Dr. Yadav, so you are giving me an open invitation to join you, okay?
Yeah, it is. Okay.
And also, we always regard Dr. Yadav and Mrs. Yadav and their children as our family members. So we always continue like that only. Thank you. Then now I will start my lecture. Can you see my slides?
Yes, madam. We can.
Yes.
Yeah, today I'm going to start my lecture about the design and development of homogeneous and heterogeneous catalyst for sustainable chemical industry. And greetings from ICT Mumbai. And I joined in IACT in 1984, and the IACT was established in 1944, and I was there in IACT up to 2015. So all my life was at IACT, 32 years I spent my life at IACT. And this institute is dedicated to serve the nation in the area of chemical sciences and technology. And before joining IACT, I did my PhD and MSc in Kurukshetra University. After my PhD, I joined at JMJ College, Andhra Pradesh, and where I did my graduation. Then they wanted me to make a permanent, then I left because I always fascinated with the research, and then I joined IACT as a postdoctoral fellow, and later I was appointed as a scientist to be. So my journey at IACT continued up to 2015. Then after my superannuation, I joined Tejpur University. And because the Tejpur University Vice Chancellor, Professor M.K. Chaudhary, and he asked me to join as a professor in April. So immediately I joined Tejpur University, but before that I got in ICT Mumbai also by Professor G.D. Yadav also offered me. But I said that I have already offered at Tejpur University. I want to spend some time in Northeast, so I will help these Northeast people also. So I joined Tejpur University and I was there for 8 months, and then again in December 2015, I joined ICT. As you know that the Institute of Chemical Technology is a very well-known institute. It was established as University Department of Chemical Technology, UDCT, in 1933 of the Mumbai University. Later in 2008, it became a deemed university. And then now you can see that A plus one grade by NAC. And then in 2018, we have two more campuses. One is ICT Bhubaneswar, another is ICT Jalna. So now we have the three campuses, and main campus is Institute of Chemical Technology. And as you know, it is a vibrant institute, and it brightens the future of chemical, biological, materials and energy industries of the nation. And it ranks among the very best in the world through active participation. As you know that from the ICT, there were 600 entrepreneurs who have started their own industry. And this, our Mukesh Ambani is also a graduate of ICT. And then again, if you can name Pidilite Industries, Garuda Industries, Asian Paints, and Anjireddy, Reddy Labs, there are all the students of ICT, and our Ramaro sir, and he is also a product of ICT, Avra Labs. So you can see that number of industries proliferated from the ICT. And also you see that we shall be creators of sprouting knowledge and design cutting edge technologies that will have the greatest impact on society and benefit of the mankind at large. And then I always start my lectures with Mahatma Gandhi's word, that is, there is enough for everyone's need, but not enough for anyone's greed. So we have to think about the sustainable development, and chemists have to play a major role on this. And then again, I will say the Abdul Kalam's words, and he said that technology, unlike science, is a group activity. And it is not based on an individual intelligence, but on the interacting intelligence of many. So when you want a technology, you need a chemist, you need a biologist, you need a mechanical engineering, design engineering, analytical, everybody you need. Unless you have all these people, you cannot make any technology. So this is the intelligence, but on the interacting intelligence of many, that is the technology. And also when you come to the global chemical industry, as you see that the world turnover is $4.1 trillion in 2013, and now it has, by 2021, it is $5.1 trillion. And what are these? One is the base chemicals, and also 45%. You may ask, what are the base chemicals? Base chemicals are nothing but petrochemicals, fertilizers, other inorganic and inorganic chemicals. And then again, pharmaceuticals 27% and specialty chemicals 22%, which is dyes, pigments, leather chemicals, construction chemicals, etc. And 1% agrochemicals, insecticides, herbicides, fungicides, and other crop protection chemicals. And then biotechnology 5%, that is biopharma, bioagri, and bioindustrial. And coming to that Indian chemical industry, the size of the Indian chemical industry is $108.4 billion. And it is sixth largest in the world and third largest in Asia. And it accounts for more than 3% of the global chemical industry. And as you can see that the basic chemicals and petrochemicals, you can see the Reliance, ONGC, and so many industries, so Oil India, so many, we have the petrochemicals, there are the top industries. And pharmaceuticals, as you know, that Ahmedabad, Hyderabad, and Bombay, they are very well known for these pharmaceutical-based industries. And coming to the specialty chemicals, agrochemicals, you can see the industry here, agrochemicals 2% and biotechnology 3%. This is the India, how many we are there in making the percentage of the chemicals in India. And what is the catalysis? And catalysis is very important. And you can see that there are homogeneous catalyst and heterogeneous catalyst, or a polymer catalyst, organocatalyst, and biocatalyst. And you see that when you are doing the catalyst by design, you should know the modeling. So theoretical tools to catalyst design. And also you should know that what are the characterization techniques of a catalyst by NMR, IR, XPS, TEM, XFACS. So you should know that how to characterize if you want to make any material. And what is that humanity's top 10 problems? You see that energy, water, food, environment, poverty, terrorism and war, disease, education, democracy, and population. And if you see that energy, all the materials, there are plays an important role. And water purification, yes, materials plays an important role. And food, again, agricultural chemicals, and again, environment cleaning. And then disease to make any of the pharmaceuticals. So this catalysis is a fascinating science. And it has the potential to solve the majority of the problems the world is facing today, directly or indirectly. So the world is driven today by the concept of sustainability through innovation, and catalysis is one of the major force to reckon with. And what is that catalysis and industry? The chemical industry depends on the catalyst, and we depend on chemical industry for our 21st century life. We depend on the catalyst. And the statistics is the 90% of the process in chemical industry uses catalyst. And the catalyst sales were in between $20.6 billion and will reach $34.4 billion in 2025. So you can see the import of the catalyst in the industries. So everybody knows about what is the chemical reaction and what is the catalyst. And if the rate of a chemical reaction is affected by the presence of a substance, which it remains unchanged in the reaction, this phenomenon is a catalysis. And the substance involved is called as a catalyst. So what is that catalyst gives? And the catalyst provides an alternative mechanism for the chemical reaction with a lower activation energy. So you can see the take the starting material, natural gas, coal, shale, cast, and biomass, and you will get the chemical product like fuels, plastics, medicines, you will get from these starting materials. And any material that is the catalyst should have some key characteristics. What that have, it is a good activity and it should be high selectivity. For example, you are doing a chemical reaction and A plus B, you need C, but you will get a D also. So you see the B, C is 50% and D is 50%. Then it's not a selective reaction. But if A plus B gives C 100%, then the reaction can be called as a highly selective reaction. So the catalyst gives high selectivity and long operating life, simple regeneration. You can see in petrochemicals, they will alkylation and other saying they will load a catalyst and years together, there is no need to take out the catalyst and the continuous process, it is going on. And what about after 1 year, you have to simply take it out and then regenerate, and then again you can use it. So the catalyst should be compatibility with the process and robustness, and also you should not leach when you are doing a reaction. And also you should see that low cost. For example, you are giving a process and with a catalyst like platinum and palladium, then it will be very expensive catalyst. So maybe your process is good, but the process cost is very high. So nobody will take your process. So it should be low cost, should be. And then what is that ideal synthesis? These are in the green chemistry. You can see it should be atom efficient. It should be safe and it should be simple, 100% yield. And you have to use with available materials, and it should be environmentally acceptable and no wasted reagent. And then also you have to see, it should be a one-step process. When you are making about the catalyst design, what are the properties is important. Physical properties like surface area, pore structure and pore density are very important. And chemical properties is oxidation state and acidity, surface composition, there are also very important. And the catalytic properties, activity and selectivity. When you are measuring a efficiency of a chemical reaction, you should see that reaction yield is quantity of the products obtained by the theoretical maximum quantity of the product. And a reaction selectivity, the quantity of the desired product by the quantity of the substrate converted. And the E factor is total quantity of the waste and quantity of the product obtained. So any chemical reaction efficiency depends upon an E factor. For example, you can see that oil refining, the product tonnage is very high. And it will be 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 8. And they use a catalyst, so the E factor is very less. That is, the kg of the byproduct by kg of the product is very less. And when you go for the bulk chemicals, you can see it is product tonnage increases 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 6, but the E factor increases. Whereas you go for the fine chemicals and pharmaceuticals, you can see there will be a number of steps. And also you don't use catalyst.
Is it a network problem?
That can we make it a catalytic processes, and then you can see that you will go get that one is a E factor you can decrease. So the lower the E factor, higher the process efficiency. And also you can see the periodic table of elements, and this is the periodic table of elements, and you will see that iron, cobalt, nickel, palladium, ruthenium, rhodium, osmium, iridium, platinum, they're all very good catalytic elements. And also when you go for a support, you can put these metals on support like titanium oxide, aluminum oxide, silicon oxide, carbon. So these are called as supports. And promoters, you can see, you can promote the with a lanthanum, you can add a little bit of zirconium, you can increase the rate of a reaction. So these are all called as a promoters. And poisons, for example, if you can see in the petrochemical industries, there is a sulfur poison. So you should be free from the sulfur, like that mercury poison. So you should be, these are act as a poisons for a catalyst. And also when you are doing a reaction, you have to see, for example, you are using aluminum fluoride. It is a Lewis acid. For example, again, you have to see the Lewis acidity or Bronsted acidity or the Lewis basicity or the Bronsted acidity. So if any material has a Lewis acid, so you can use it for a Lewis acidic reaction, and also you can Bronsted acid, for you can use the one for the acidic reaction. Like that, it depends upon the basicity and the acidity of a reactions. And also you can see the chemistry for healthcare. For example, as you know that you know the cancer, without chemistry can we make the Taxol? No. Like that penicillin for infections and the donepezil for Alzheimer's and aspirin, acetyl salicylic acid, pain and headache and AIDS, AGT and insulin for diabetes and malaria, quinine, chloroquinine and asthma, corticosterone. You know that the chemists have synthesized various molecules for the treatment, and you see that the catalysis is very important in making all these molecules. And I give you some examples of these catalytic reactions. For example, you take a C-C coupling reaction, and it was invented by Heck and Negishi and Suzuki, and they got a Nobel Prize in 2010 and for palladium catalyzed cross-coupling in organic synthesis. And you see that what is the important of these C-C coupling reactions. Palladium catalyzed cross-coupling is used in the research worldwide, as well as in the commercial production of the pharmaceuticals and molecules used in the electron industry. And I will give you some of the examples of the C-C coupling reaction. For example, what is a C-C coupling reaction? You can take an aryl halide. This X, it may be a chloro compound, it may be a bromo compound, iodo compound, fluoro compound, and you take an olefin, and you can see that you react with palladium chloride and triphenylphosphine as a ligand, and you can get the stilbene derivatives. In this case, what will happen? You can palladium chloride and PPH3, they can activate in the only the bromo and iodo compounds, which are very expensive. Whereas if you want to activate the chloro compound, you need a special, this is cyclophene and phosphine, and you use palladium dibenzyl acetone. These are the activated, and you need these phosphines to activate the chloro compound. So then there are phosphopalladocycle, adamantane phosphine, and these are all the which they made for making the activation of the chloro compound. And as you see that what is the important of the Heck reaction, and you see the herbicide prosulfuron, you can see it is taking this one, and you can see the olefin compound, and you will make this prosulfuron by using the Heck reaction. And also you see that a chloro compound, and again it is a hydro compound, again you will make this compound using the Heck reaction. So this is the anti-asthma agent. And again you can see that anti-cancer agent, also you take an hydro compound and you take an olefin, and without this Heck reaction you cannot make this reaction. And also rilpivirine, which is used for HIV infection, again you can see iodo compound and olefin compound and palladium on carbon, and you can see the Heck reaction using for the rilpivirine. And also this Heck reaction, also you can see the naproxen. You can take a bromo compound and olefin, and you will get this naproxen, also anti-inflammatory drug. And also you can see that it again the bromo compound, and it can do the C-C coupling, and you will get the octomethoxacinamide, which is a sunscreen agent. So without Heck reaction, you cannot make these compounds. So what we have done is we did some phosphine-free catalyst. Because why phosphine-free catalyst? Because you can see that phosphines are very, they are moisture sensitive and air sensitive, and they need a glow box and also multi-step process. So what we thought is, instead of the phosphines, can we make the imidate complexes? So what we did is, you just take a phenylalanine and thionyl chloride, and you will make this one, and again react with picolinic acid and lithium hydroxide, you will get this imidate pyridyl carbonic acid. This carbonic acid and reacted with methyl aminopyridine in presence of DCC, it will give you an imidate complex. And this imidate complex, the ligand, this when you treated with palladium acetate, you will get the palladium complex. You can see the bonding with the palladium with the pyridine, and then imidate bonding, you can see this is a palladium complex. It can be easily, and the important is this complex is not moisture sensitive and oxygen sensitive, and you don't need glow box, and you can make it very easily, and it is very stable. And we did the X-ray structure, determine the complex also. And the most important is, you can see this complex also Heck reaction of aryl chloride. So I told you in the beginning, activation of the chloro compound is difficult, but this complex, this can activate the chloro compounds, you will get the stilbene derivatives with very high yield. And again, when we thought of, we did with a homogeneous complex, and then we thought that why don't you go do a heterogeneous complex. Then we got this hydrotalcite. Hydrotalcite are nothing but brucites, magnesium hydroxide. If you replace one of the magnesium with aluminum, there is a charge imbalance. And then to balance the charge, you will need the anions like chloride or carbonate, so that hydrotalcite, you can make it very easily. And how you can make it hydrotalcite, you can see. And you take a magnesium chloride and you take aluminum chloride. It is nothing but magnesium aluminum mixed hydroxides. So you take a magnesium chloride and you take an aluminum chloride and you make the pH 10 with the ammonium hydroxide, and you will get the chloride hydrotalcite. You can see magnesium and aluminum, and is there chloride hydrotalcite. This is the chloride anion is there. So what we have, why we made this hydrotalcite, because the phosphines are basic and LDH, that is the Le double hydroxide or hydrotalcites, are basic. So with that idea, and the reactions are known, what we have to do is how you will design a catalyst is important. So this chloride anion, and you can also make carbonate ion. If you take the magnesium carbonate and aluminum chloride or magnesium nitrate and react with sodium carbonate and sodium hydroxide, pH maintain, you will get the magnesium aluminum carbonates, and you calcine, you will get the hydroxides. And without calcination, you see you can get the chloride, and you exchange with the palladium complex, and then it is a palladium two state, and then you reduce with hydrogen hydrate, and you will get the palladium zero on the hydrotalcite. And we have completely characterized the catalyst, and by TEM analysis, the size of the palladium nanoparticles we have determined is 4 to 6, and by XPS we know the oxidation state of the palladium. And why we need the catalyst, because instead of the phosphines, you can put your palladium on the support. So we put a palladium on the hydrotalcite support, which is very basic and anybody can make in the lab. You just need magnesium nitrate or magnesium chloride, aluminum chloride, and sodium hydroxide or sodium carbonate or ammonium hydroxide, and palladium salts, and anybody can make in kilos. And you see that what is important, because of the basicity of the support, and you can see you can activate the chloro compound. You take an aryl chloride and you can react with olefin, and you will get the stilbene derivatives. You can see this is the reaction is known and the product is known. How you will design a catalyst with a cheap material, and they are not moisture sensitive, oxidant sensitive. And also the importance is these are heterogeneous catalyst, and you can filter the catalyst and you can reuse it a number of times. And again, coming to that Suzuki reaction, and Suzuki, what is the difference between Heck reaction and Suzuki reaction? And you see that here also you can take aryl halides with the bromo or chloro and the fluoro, any halides. And but only thing is, instead of a olefin, you react with a boronic acid, and you can see that you can get the biphenyl. This is a very important reaction called as a Suzuki reaction. And why Suzuki reaction is important? Again, you can see boronic acid and the chloro compound, you can make the fungicide boscalide, and by using a Suzuki reaction. And also when you are going for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, Crohn's disease, and psoriasis, yes, you need all these Suzuki reaction. Without Suzuki reaction, you cannot make the naphthopyridine. So this is Suzuki reaction is very important. And again, you want to make the drugs for the Alzheimer's disease. Again, you can see boronic acid, and you can take the iodo compound, and then you will make this Suzuki reaction. And also they use for selective nuclear hormone receptor modulator also you can make. And the most important of the Suzuki reaction is, you can see the, you use it in the treatment of the hypertensive and high blood pressure. This reaction, you can see OTBN, orthotolobenzonitrile, or you can see the chlorobenzonitrile. These are orthochlorobenzonitrile. These are made using the Suzuki reaction. You can see this reaction, and here you can see the bromo benzonitrile, and you react with boronic acid, you will get this reaction. This is the ortho-tolo-benzonitrile, and then it reacts with alkylation and then tetrazole formation. So if you want to make any losartan, candesartan, diolmesartan, elmesartan, telmesartan, any sartan derivatives, this without Suzuki reaction, you cannot make. So you can see the importance of the Suzuki reaction. So what we have done is the same catalyst, we have taken LDH palladium reaction, and then you can take the bromo compound and boronic acid. And the important is you can see the reaction, you can do at room temperature and 12 hours. And also you can take ethanol and water mixture and you will get the biphenyl derivatives very easily. And also you can reuse the catalyst. So similarly, this same catalyst can be used for Sonnegischler reaction and Stille-type coupling of chloroarenes. And also we have given the mechanisms also how it goes to make this one. And again, you can see the another reaction with hydrotalcide. You can see the significance and traditional methods employed for the synthesis of amides. You see the amide bond formation is one of the most used in transformation in the synthesis of pharmaceuticals, fine chemicals, and polymers. And it is estimated that more than 25% of known drugs contain amide group. You can see captopril and the treatment of hyperdrag. And you can see the amide bond, and also nylon 6,6 and aspartame, anti then acetylpyramide, and all these consist of the amide bond. So what we thought, usually how they make the amides is involves the coupling reaction of amine with a carboxylic acid, and you will get the amide bond. And also instead of this carboxylic acid, you can also different activated carboxylic acid. You can use acyl halide, acyl azide, acid anhydride, esters, and you will get this one. What we have done is simply we take the acid and we take the DMF and you see the copper iron hydrotalcite, and we use the TBHP as an oxidant and tertiary butyl hydroperoxide, and 80 degrees you can get the dimethyl benzamide. And you can very easily make this using the hydrotalcide catalyst. And you can see oxidative coupling of benzyl acid with the DMF over, and you see the normal benzoic acid and substituted benzoic acid. You can take any fluoro, bromo, and nitro, all groups you can see, and chloro, and you can make the amides very easily using the simple. Instead of the earlier, I showed hydrotalcite with palladium, and you can see copper iron hydrotalcite catalyst you can. And also same oxidative coupling reaction of benzaldehyde with DMF over same catalyst. You can take instead of benzoic acid, you can take the benzaldehyde and you will get the amides very easily. And again, we went for another catalytic CN bond formation reaction. And you see that CN bond formation reactions are why important. You can see benzolactones you can make, and you can intermediate for ethoxylate. So many compounds you make, and the linezolid intermediate. So these compounds, the imidazoles are very important. So CN coupling is very important. So what we have taken is, again, we have taken another material that is calcium hydroxyphosphate. And this calcium hydroxyphosphate is nothing but hydroxyapatite. And you can see this is the apatite's synthetic biomaterials and the constituent of orthopedic calcium phosphate and composite the biomaterials. And you can see the our bones and dental, these are all made up of the apatites that is called hydroxyapatite. And this hydroxyapatite, again, why we have chosen this hydroxyapatite? Again, it is a base and like a phosphine. So this is very easy to make. You take a calcium nitrate and ammonium hydrogen phosphate, and you will make the calcium hydrogen phosphate that is hydroxyapatite. And you want to increase more basicity, you exchange with the ammonium fluoride, you will get the calcium hydroxyfluoroapatite. And wanted to do the tertiary butoxide, and you exchange with tertiary butoxide, you will get the tertiary butoxyapatite. And then you exchange with the copper, you will get the copper fluoroapatite and also copper fluorohydroxyapatite. You can see that why this again you can see the CN bond formation. You take an imidazole and again you take an aryl halide chloro or fluoro, and you will take your copper fluoroapatite catalyst in DMF, and you will get the substituted imidazoles very easily using this catalyst. And also the time and the yields are very good, and also you can use it to reuse it, and then this catalyst is very good in making the CN bond formation, making the substituted imidazoles. So what is that important is you can take an apatite as a support, you can take an hydrotalcite as a support, and similarly we did with osmium hydrotalcite, and we did the asymmetric dihydroxylation. You can make the taxol derivatives using this one, like that asymmetric hydroxylation, and you can take the rhodium base Hillman-Edex, and then you can see the simply these reactions are very well known, and only how you design your catalyst, either you take an apatite and hydrotalcite, you put your metals, and you can do wonders. And here again we went for the making the nano magnesium oxide, and here what we have done is we have a collaboration with Professor Clavende at Kansas State University, and he is making the nano magnesium oxide with an aerosol method. You can see the nano magnesium oxide, the surface area is very high, so because of the surface area you can do a number of reactions, and you can see the nano magnesium oxide is a polyhedral shape, whereas the commercial magnesium oxide is a cubic shape. And you can see the surface area is 30, whereas you can see the nano magnesium oxide surface area very, very high. And also he has given the complete structure of the nanocrystalline magnesium oxide. As I told you that you need a Lewis acid site or a Bronsted basic sites or a Lewis basic sites. So you can see the nanocrystalline magnesium oxide. It consists of magnesium 2 plus Lewis acid type and O2 minus, which is a Lewis base type, and OH in the hydroxyl is a Bronsted basic site. So you can do this magnesium, this nano magnesium oxide, you can do, and you can do a number of reactions using the either Lewis acid site or Lewis base or the Bronsted basic sites. And here you can see the Claisen-Schmidt condensation for making the chalcones. You take an aldehyde, you take an acetone or anything, and you can take the, you can make the chalcones, and you can see the chalcones have been characterized with multiple biological activity, including anti-inflammatory, anti-malaria. You can make the chalcone very easily. You can take the carbonyl compound and you can make it. And here you can see, and shape, what we did is we have taken the nanocrystalline magnesium oxide to making the chalcones. And here you see that nanocrystalline magnesium oxide, the reaction takes place in 12 hours, whereas the commercial magnesium oxide, it takes 50 hours. And what we thought is, we don't know that, similarly, we have taken the benzaldehyde with various acetophenones, and we get the various chalcones with the benzaldehyde and acetophenone. And here I told you that when you are taking this one, and the reaction takes place in 12 hours. So we don't know that it is maybe a Lewis basic sites or a Bronsted basic sites. OH is responsible. So when we do the reaction is 12 hours. So what we thought is, we don't know that Bronsted basic sites are important or Lewis basic sites are important. So we have silicated the Bronsted basic sites, and the reaction takes place in 20 hours. It takes place, but the reaction time increases. So that means it shows that both the Bronsted basic sites as well as the Lewis basic sites are important to do the Claisen-Schmidt condensation. And similarly, this nano magnesium oxide, because of this Lewis acid sites and basic sites, and you can see, you can do the synthesis of flavonones, you can do the Strecker reaction, cyanosylylation, epoxidation, Wittig reaction, Bohr-Simons reaction. You can do the number of reactions using with the nano magnesium oxide. And this one nanocrystalline magnesium oxide can be also used as a support. Similarly, when we put the hydrotalcite as a support and we have put the palladium on this, here also what we did is we have taken magnesium oxide as a support and we put the palladium on this one, and then again we reduced with hydrogen hydrate. You will get the palladium zero on the magnesium oxide support. And what is the importance of this reaction? You can see that when you want to do the reduction of the nitro compounds, when you use a catalyst and you need the hydrogen pressure and you need a high temperatures to make the nitro compounds to amino compounds. What is the importance of the amines? Amines are important starting materials for dyestuffs, pharmaceuticals, agrochemicals, and surfactants, pesticides. So what we did is you can take the nanomagnesium oxide palladium catalyst and with a, just we put a balloon and yes, you can do the reaction at room temperature and you can do the reduction of the nitro compounds to amino compounds. The most important use, you can see the paranitrophenol and you will get the paraaminophenol, which is an important to make the paraestimol. So in 1.5 hours, we get the 98%. And the important is the catalyst can be reused for a number of cycles. And again, we went for the carbon hydrogen bond activation, which is very important. And you can replace the carbon hydrogen bond with a X, that is a carbon, or carbon oxygen or nitrogen, which is very important. As you know, this commercially carbamides are very important. Why the important? You can see the physostigmine, neostigmine, rivastigmine. They use it for the glaucoma and also Alzheimer's, Parkinson's diseases. These can be, there are carbamate group is very important in these molecules and also insecticides and herbicides, carbofuran and aldicarb. This is carbaryl also. These carbamate groups are very important. As you know that the carbamates, when you are making, everybody knows about the Bhopal diester and you can see the methylamine when reacts with the phosgene, it will produce the methyl isocyanate and which reacts with one naphthol and use the carbaryl. And you can see the 1984, December 2 to 3rd in the Union Carbide plant, it happened. People were exposed to methyl isocyanate. And you can see the number of people were dead and then so many injuries. And still we cannot forget the Bhopal gas disaster to making the carbaryl. So what we thought is we can make the synthesis of carbamates very easily. There are reports making from the carbon dioxide. And also what we thought is we can make it very easily. So what we did, we took the beta keto esters and here we have taken dimethyl formamide. And in the presence of a copper bromide, and we use the tertiary butyl hydroperoxide as an oxidant, and we did the reaction, and we will get the enol esters very easily. And also similarly, you will take the phenols also, alkylated phenols, and you will react with dimethyl formamide or any formamide, you will get the phenol esters also very easily. And why formamide as a reactant? You can see the DMF is basically as a solvent and DMF is also a reactant. So due to its nature, it will act differently under different reaction conditions and it gives the methyl isocyanate and it gives the methyl, formyl, oxygen, ligand and nitrogen and oxygen. So anybody can make these compounds and we took the formamide. And again, you can see you take the beta keto esters and dimethyl formamide and copper bromide and tertiary butyl hydroperoxide 80 degrees and you will get the enol esters very easily. And then it only reacts with alkylated phenols. With simple phenols, it doesn't react. So what we thought is if you take any ligand and it can act. So what we did is we took the copper acetate and 110 phenanthrolate and again dimethyl formamide and TBHP and you will get the with from the phenols also you can get the carbamates very easily. And the most important is you can see this dimethyl formamide, copper acetate and tertiary butyl hydroperoxide and you will get the any phenol carbamates very easily. And the important is you can see here N-methyl formamide we take, copper acetate, TBHP, 110 phenanthrolate, and you see that you take the naphthol and N-methyl formamide, you can make the carbaryl very easily. You don't need to use the phosgene gas where the Bhopal diester happened, and you can make the same compound just using the dimethyl formamide, alpha naphthol, copper acetate, and TBHP, 110 phenanthrolate. and room temperature, same compound you can make without using the phosgene. And again, we went for the nitration. Nitration is usually done with the using a sulfuric acid and nitric acid, and but we have devised a catalyst. When you use the toluene nitration, and you will get the ortho compound more, 76%, whereas the para compound is less. But when we use a zeolite catalyst, you can exchange the selectivities. You can see the para selective nitration, you will get more than 60% of para nitro toluene. And we have a paper and we have a patent also. And what we have taken, we took the zeolite, and zeolite anybody can make. You take a silica source, alumina source, water, cation store, and structured directive agent, and you put it all together in an autoclave 100 degrees, and you can make the zeolite very easily in any lab. And here what we did is we have done the batch mode with the beta zeolite with silicon aluminum ratio 15, 22, and 27, and you can see the conversion is 55% in a batch mode, and you see the selectivities, para selectivities, 66%. And also when we did this reaction experimentally, and we also proved by modeling that it gives the same para selectivity. And here again, when we went for a pilot plant, and you can see the solid acid catalyst, and when we are going for a pilot plant, when you are doing a continuous reaction, you don't have to use the powder catalyst. You need a catalyst within a pellet form. But for making the pellets, you get the same conversion and same selectivity is very difficult. And we worked for 1 year to get the same conversion and same selectivity. And we did the pilot plant studies, and 1 year we are getting the same product and same conversion. So what is the highlight is we can dispense the use of sulfuric acid, and we did the pilot plant studies, but the commercial plant was discussed, but it was not commercialized. And similarly, you can also apply to xylenes and chlorobenzenes also you can do. And these are all the patents we have on this nitration of the toluene. And again, whenever product, we went for the paramethoxyphenylacetic acid, which is used in the dextromethor. And also, you can see that the solid acid catalyst, you take a phenol and you will make the anisole, this technology also with us. And then we made a solid acid catalyst to make the paramethoxyestophenone. And then again, Willegrad reaction, you will make the paramethoxyphenylacetic acid. And the commercial plant is coming up using the technology, and you see that the paramethoxyestophenone and bench scale demonstration was done, and then basically this paramethoxyestophenone used as a fragrance and a flavoring input, and also it used for the evobenzene also sunscreen agent. And then the process we have developed at IACT and continuous mode fixed bed reactor and non-expensive catalyst, and the pilot plant studies were under progress at IACT. And also you see that zeolite catalyst, anisole, and a stick and headed paramethoxyestophenone. And we have a patent also. And again, the catalytic process, isobutyl estophenone also, we did with isobutyl benzene and a stick and headed, as you know, that isobutyl estophenone used for the ibuprofen. And we did a reaction in a batch reactor, but the zeolite is expensive when compared with aluminum chloride, so we cannot commercialize. If anybody come with a very good catalyst to make this one, people are ready to take this one. And similarly, again, the methoxynaphthalene also a stick anhydride, and also you will get the zeolite catalyst, and again, you can give the acyl naphthyl ether, which also goes into the naproxen. And again, we have now people always like continuous process. In the batch process, you have to do the filtration and other things. So we have developed another process for the paracimin, and you take the toluene and isopropyl alcohol, zeolite catalyst in a continuous reactor, you will get the paracimin and the 49% conversion and with 80% selectivity. And this one used in the tonalide synthesis and cosmetics, food product and medicine. This medical purposes, and this will be commercialized soon by us. And another process is the making the pentanone using a solid acid catalyst. Here also, we have developed a catalyst to be using the, from the propionic acid. Again, it is a fixed bed reaction at 450 degrees, and you will get the 3-pentanone. And the pentanone used as a solvent and in medicines, and we have demonstrated to a private party. And coming to the last is, and we have developed the technology. When I was in IACT, we have developed the technology for the para-tetrabutyltoluene and para-tetrabutylbenzoic acid and methyl para-tetrabutylbenzoate also. And you can ask what are the uses. You can see the para-tetrabutyltoluene is used as a solvent and intermediate for organic synthesis. And it is widely used as a catalyst and additive for cooling and lubricant. And methyl para-tetrabutylbenzoate is used as a flavoring agent, masking agent, perfuming agent, and it is used in making the sunscreen agent. And we have developed a process exclusively a single isomer in the para-tetrabutyltoluene and low catalyst loading, high yield. And also here in the when making the para-tetrabutylbenzoic acid, we use the air as an oxidant and recyclable catalyst and high yield and purity, and also methyl para-tetrabutylbenzoate also recyclable catalyst, and we have filed all provisional patents. And you can see the how the technology comes in for the goes for the commercialization. And when you see the process for alkylation of toluene with isobutylene together, you can see we have demonstrated the process on 300-gram scale in March 2013. And you can see this one is a para-tetrabutylbenzoic acid, and again we have developed from the air oxidation, and this is also we have 10 bar pressure and 130 degrees centigrade 6 hours, and this process demonstrated 100-gram scale in March 2013. And when you go for the scale-up studies and basic design report for commercial plant of 12 tons per day of para-tetrabutyltoluene, you can see we have a 5 kg per hour continuous mode we have developed, and we have developed 70% conversion, 100% selectivity. And when you see that when you have demonstrated in the 2013, and when pilot plant we have demonstrated in 2014 for this para-tetrabutyltoluene. And similarly, you can see that we have designed this commercial plant and the 10 tons per day of para-tetrabutylbenzoic acid, and we have demonstrated in a 20 liter autoclave and downstream processes involved, and these are we have demonstrated in 2014. And as you know that this one, you can see the commercial plant came in here in Lote Parshuram by an industry, and they are making 4,000 tons per year. In 2019 it came. So we started the product in lab scale demonstration in 2013, and the pilot scale 2014, and the commercial plant came in 2019. You can see how happy we are, and we have demonstrated. And this is the commercial plant for the para-tetrabutylbenzoic acid, and 3,000 tons per year we have developed. And this also, they have industry has commercialized, and we have got the Technology Development Board Award also for this process. And when we are demonstrating any process, you have to see the product quality, and you see that appearance, the market, and also IACT product, you have to see appearance is a clear colorless liquid, and SA, boiling point, density, and also tetrabutylbenzoic acid, a white crystalline powder, and the purity and iron impurity, how much melting point. So we have to meet the all parameters. And also first is the not only parameters, and you have to see that you have to meet the consumption of the raw materials and cost also you have to see. And here we have, when the pilot plant only, we have demonstrated what will be the cost. And based on this cost only, they will go for the commercial plant. And you can see the toluene catalyst for alkylation, oxidation, how much acetic acid consumption, and price of raw material, you can see 94 rupees. And when the price of the para-tetrabutylbenzoic acid is 245, and the price of the paratensibutyl ester also 290 rupees, and you can see the how the you can make per kg this much means for 3000 tons you can see the what is in the calculations. And also the some of the technologies which we have demonstrated in IACT is the pyrazinamide, and you can see the tetrabromo bisphenol from bisphenol, which is used as a flame retardant. Dimethyl ether, now everybody is after dimethyl ether, and paramethoxyphenylnitric acid, methyl mercaptan to methyl sulfonic acid. We have demonstrated to industry they are making the methyl mercaptan into methyl sulfonic acid. And again, furfural, and you can see the we have developed a process for ammonium dinitramide, which is used as a rocket propellant. And you can see this one, we have given the VSSC Vikram Sarabhai space, and the triphenyl phosphine we have given to United Phosphorus, and nitrotoluenes, melanonitrile, nitrotizolol we gave to that high energy research laboratory, and tertiary toluene, tertiary benzoic acid, and waste plastic to fuel oils we have given to a one company in Chennai. And what is the primary role of catalysis? You can see the process intensification, and also you see the energy savings. You can save the energy, and also the economy also, and also environment you save. So the new challenge before the chemist and engineer today to develop innovative catalytic processes for utilization of biomass. Because of the lack of time, I didn't told you about the biomass for fuels and chemicals. On that also we are working, and we are going to commercialize some of the products from the biomass to chemicals. So why biomass is to address the issue of the sustainability and fast dwindling of the petroleum resources. Biomass is very important. And the goals and the challenges and the opportunities, you can see the vision and technology targets remain relevant. So selective oxidation is important, alkane activation is important, and byproduct and waste minimization is also important, and also stereoselective synthesis and functional olefin polymerization, alkylation, and alternative feedstocks and renewables, they are all important. And you can see the future of the chemical industry, where we are and where we have to be. You can see where we are and where we have to be, and you see the future of the chemical industry. And also the memorable moments of IACT and at ICT, you can see the Dr. Yadav, Dr. Chagarajan, me and Dr. Ramarao, Dr. Raghavan, these are all the directors of the IACT. And also you can see in ICT, we have Professor Nayori, he has visited Nobel Laureate for our convocation, and Dr. G.D. Yadav, our former director and at ICT. And also my acknowledgement is ICT Mumbai and Godrej Consumer Products, who has given me Godrej Chair Professor and J.C. Bose Fellowship, and CSR, IACT, all my collaborators and the students who without them we can't do anything. And RMIT University and Tejpur University, the University of Newcastle, and my present team, these are all my postdocs and PhD students. And these are the one who are working now with all the industrial projects with us. So thank you.
Thank you, madam, for wonderful lecture. Thank madam, you. Would you like to give some answer our students' questions?
Yeah.
Now session is open for questions. Dear student, if you have any questions, please.
Give me if they have.
Yeah.
Oh, very good attendance is there, Lakshmi.
Hello, sir.
You got more attendance than SRM here, I can tell you. I don't know. How many people are on Facebook? Abhinav, any idea?
So here it
must be more than 50, 60. Here 60, so almost like 150.
150 on weekend.
I just saw 90 or something like that. Earlier,
No, that you see on the internet, but there are on Facebook.
On Facebook.
Facebook number will not appear here.
I don't have Facebook also.
No.
So madam, the palladium catalyst you use, you develop, no? That was that is using vastly in the optoelectronics material synthesis.
Yeah.
CC bond formation, Suzuki, Heck,
and yeah.
Especially Sonogashira. When I was doing PhD, I use catalyst, what we done on solid surface, that I use for Sonogashira reaction.
Yeah. It is known for the, because the same catalyst, it works for Stille and Sonogashira also. We have some papers also with the SP Singh for your materials also. We made some of the materials. Yeah, you remember? Yes,
Yeah, because in normal Suzuki Sonogashira, there is a problem of singlet oxygen, free oxygen. So, but using your catalyst, we don't need to worry about that oxygen.
That's true, because we did also some materials, electronic materials and other things, So, he is scaling up of some of the processes also,
You know, I don't know, Gyanchandra is not attending, but Rajesh.
Yes, sir.
Now, you see, no, Cadila is doing a lot of backward integration.
Yes, sir.
Might have noticed many of her reactions were like, where you can get catalyst.
Catalyst, yes, madam.
And especially all sartans.
Sir, you tell the product, I will send you the catalyst, you can do it there, that's all.
So, sartan, especially all the sartan, you see.
Sartans is very good, That's why.
Yeah.
I did for Haikal, na. So that's why I can't give. I can give catalyst if you want to do it. You can do it.
No, that is, you say, non-inclusive.
No, different catalyst, na. We can develop different catalyst, na. So that's why if you can name anything you want, I will send the catalyst, sir. You can work.
Okay, very good.
Yeah.
Listen, Rajesh.
Yes, sir.
Anything, any you want think electronic of, materials
for ourselves, anything,
anything you want. You because I didn't tell sir, oxidation catalyst we have, hydrogenation also I didn't tell.
You might have noticed the strength of Lakshmi is catalyst people, you know, they know only catalyst. They don't know the organic chemistry. Just like new catalyst. There are, I can name it. There are many chemical engineers, they know only chemical engineering, not no chemistry. But you know, one like similar analogy I'm telling, G.D. Yadav and M.M. Sarma, you know why they become more popular?
Because of the chemistry,
They also know chemistry.
Engineering.
So Lakshmi, can you say she's not an organic chemist?
Madam done multi-step synthesis.
Can you tell that Lakshmi is not an organic chemist?
No, sir, I can't say that one because there are huge reactions.
Sir, that Stanford University 2%, my name is in organic chemistry, you know?
Yes, madam, we saw your name.
With you, mine is also in organic chemistry. You are the number one, I am also somewhere there.
Right, so... Yeah. It is important, you know, that
And Professor G.D. Yadav went into physical chemistry, not in chemical engineering.
That was surprise, madam. I don't know. It's in physical chemistry.
You don't know. There were an argument for G.D. Yadav for Bhatnagar Award. And he has more paper, everything more than any chemical engineer.
Yeah.
But they consider him as a physical chemist and rejected it.
I knew.
So it is, you know, sometime they have some person in mind and then they will find something.
You know much better because you are in all committees,
That's how the GD missed the Bhatnagar Award.
Polunada, is there any question in chat box?
What do you say?
No, there is one question.
Yeah.
From audience.
There is a question. Ma'am, that is what will be the challenges for derivatization of high molecular weight polysaccharides?
I didn't do on polysaccharides, So because I am working on the other bio-based compounds like xylose to xylitol, and then HMF to furan dicarboxylic acid, like that compounds I am working on, the biomass to chemicals and all that.
You know, the not Lakshmi, your geolites. Your geolites, if you can cavity, geolite combination with cyclodextrin. You can
already they did some mobilization and they did some reaction.
See, in Pali, saccharide means they are what talking selective alkylation. So you can do alkylation. And otherwise, derivatization is always there. See, there is only problem is if you want to do selective, if you want to do global.
Because they will also global restrict that because of the size.
Okay.
If there is no more question, then I would like to invite Amish sir for concluding remark. Amish sir.
Yeah, good afternoon to everyone and especially to Dr. Professor Lakshmi Kantam. I think it was the one of the finest and most interesting lecture I have heard so far. I can rate it in top 5 lectures, what I have heard so far. And the reason being, even a normal common chemical engineer can also understand from where catalyst and where it will be. This is the beauty of the lecture. You know, the last peak, if you have seen, the plant what before this and plant or chemical plant of the future, you can see the size of the plant. And if you compare the productivity will be more compared to the earlier one. And that is the beauty of the catalyst, how to use the catalyst, kind of the catalyst, may it be homogeneous or the heterogeneous catalyst. And many a time, you know, I found one question and that I would like to raise to the madam. Homogeneous catalyst, because the definition of catalyst itself is a very vague and ambiguous many a time. I also getting confused with that. If we are using homogeneous catalyst, is it fitting in the conventional catalyst definition or not?
Because usually in all your this industries, pharma industries, they use only homogeneous catalyst only. They have not started using the heterogeneous catalyst. But in some industries, we have given our catalyst and they are working very well. Because the problem is homogeneous catalyst is again the reusability, filtration, these are the problems. For example, you can see aluminum chloride, we can replace aluminum chloride in alkylation to make the paramethoxyestophenone. But whereas the same when you want to make the isobutyl estophenone for ibuprofen, or for naproxene, no, there is, we cannot beat aluminum chloride because aluminum chloride is 25 to 35 rupees and a zeolite is 1000 rupees. So we cannot beat the cost there, even if it is reusable. That's why there is a lot of things. Or if you use aluminum chloride, okay. If you can recover the aluminum chloride, if you can convert into again useful, people are doing, but still the many industries they are closing. So people are after me, can you replace aluminum chloride? So we are working, but still we don't have answers. So that's why some cases, yes, homogeneous catalyst and homogeneous reagents only.
There's, you know, this kind of dilemma always there in the mind of chemical engineers, and what Yadav sir said, that is very true. Even I also feel like the same, that being a chemical engineer, we should understand the chemistry also. And that is why, you know, if you see the curriculum of ICT, then most of the subjects are related to chemistry rather than the chemical engineering. Chemistry
see,
subjects
here
are
only in ICT, I have some 12 products with industries, Rallies, Jubilant and everywhere. So what I do is I develop a catalyst and I will give to my chemical engineering, Professor G.D. Yadav and again Professor Rathod. They will do everything. So for me, only design a reaction, making the catalyst, give them, and they will do the all upscaling and commercialization.
They will do
engineering problems. So we will work together.
But it's necessary. You know, chemical engineering could not survive without chemistry.
Once
you initiate it, then only scale-up question will be there. Otherwise, it cannot be there.
Similarly, in ISCT also, all my reactions, chemical engineering only used to do. I will not allow my chemist to do chemical engineering. For the beginning itself, it will be easy for me to upscale.
Correct.
That's why I told that any technology without chemical engineer, mechanical design, everything we need. Otherwise, we can't make any technology together. It is all together only we can make it successful.
Correct.
Lakshmikantam, one process was transferred by our TSR Prasadra, okay? From IIP Dehradun. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
So TSR Prasad Rao, he transferred one technology from IIP Dehradun. That was sulfolane. Have you heard the name sulfolane? You are on the mute.
Unmute, madam.
Yes, sir. I knew sulfolane.
Sulfolane, you know, right?
Yeah.
Now, because Cadila has been making sulfolane.
Yeah.
Now China people have prices, they have dropped so much.
Yeah.
Root is same, there is no difference.
Yeah.
The only problem is there, the rainy nickel, you know, what they use.
Huh? What is that?
They use rainy nickel for hydrogenation.
Yeah, so here my main task is removing rainy nickel with my heterogeneous nickel catalyst. So I am developing so many technologies with my catalyst. I already patented it also here.
So that problem is there.
Yeah.
And
I can give my catalyst. You can try there, sir.
Sure. And you remember Ramchandra, what is that? You were there, you know, in your division, Ramchandra. Yes.
Huh?
Who left? He was there, you know, in your division. I'm forgetting his name. He left.
Ramchandra Reddy.
Ramchandra Reddy, right.
And he is an extraction man, a metal extraction. He is doing very well in that Rupa mill.
Yeah. I was thinking to contact him.
Yeah, because unfortunately his wife expired cancer.
I know some. Yeah. I know somebody.
I have his email ID and everything. I will send you.
Okay, sent. So
he
what
is doing
happened?
Very well.
What happened? No. Actually, problem we gave to him only when you suggested him to give. What he did, the West rainy nickel, he converted into nickel chloride.
Yes. Yes.
You remember, no?
Yes.
That converted into nickel chloride and sent back.
Yeah.
So that you can sell the nickel chloride.
That's true. He is doing cobalt, nickel, so many he is doing, yes.
But still it didn't come out economical because chloride sells much cheaper than nickel, rainy nickel, obviously.
Yeah.
So still the gap is too much.
And one more industry approached us for other metals, rhodium and other things. Who is the one last time? Ivonic has approached me.
That is different. Really.
No. Metal recovery only.
Metal recovery, okay.
Yeah. Ivonic. Because last week only we had a meeting with them, yeah.
Okay. I think we'll discuss sometime one-to-one, okay?
Yeah. Definitely, sir.
Yes, sir. So, without taking much of the time here, again, I will appreciate your work, ICT work, and the lecture itself, because it gives immense, you know, amount of information to all our budding engineers also. So thank you very much, madam, for all this information. Thank you.
Thank you, Amish sir. Here I would like to invite our colleague Prakash Reddy.
Anybody wants to interact?
Yeah, if anyone want to make any comment.
Last time, after SRM, this one, they said half an hour interaction and 2 hours interaction meeting.
Okay. Lakshmi.
Yeah.
You tell these people, you know, Prakash Reddy, they're on this.
Yeah.
You are there, you know, in that physical and inorganic chairman. What kind of project we are looking in, sir?
How it is over? Last week.
Over. It will come again, no? Not coming. So what kind of project they are looking?
Because there are so many, no? This industrial thing also, no? They are star projects. They are not getting any good projects like that. Why don't you ask them to write for this star?
Okay.
Lot of money they are giving. See, industry oriented. I am in that committee also.
See, given the hint, it has to be industrial application oriented.
Yeah.
Just for publications, you won't give.
No. Industry oriented. Because you are there, so what?
Sunliya?
Yes, sir.
I also tell them, Rajinath.
Yeah. Madam, just recently we got an email saying that our core grant that we applied, it is under process just 2 days back.
Which one? You might
be knowing about that one.
Core grant, madam.
Oh, core grant, yeah.
Yes, madam.
No, you apply for this star and other things. You will get immediately. Nobody is doing that industrial work.
Okay, madam, we will go with star.
Yeah.
They have a different...
That's why, na? They have some 14. Nobody got that star.
You people should spend some time and look on the website of SERB. What kind of project they are looking.
Okay.
It is there on the website, right?
Yes, sir.
So madam, do they give a clear hint?
Madam, do they need also some like...
project?
Huh?
Do they need some preliminary result also for industrial?
Nothing. If you have, it is well and good.
Okay.
Yeah. Concept is important.
Okay.
And also there may be, you can team with other universities, other people also, like that with industry, like that also you can write.
Okay. Industry.
Okay.
Yeah. Here I would like to invite Prakash Reddy for a vote of thanks.
Right. You know, Rajesh, you are lucky.
Yes, sir.
He is, Manavir, Oscar, he presented all these things, already ready to help. But she has become, from last 10 years, very big woman.
I know, sir. I work it was... Actually, I am very lucky, sir. I work with madam 2 years.
Joking. What big. I am small. When compared with you, I am very small.
Knowledge transfer nahi hua na, Rajesh.
When compared with you,
sir, I was working on porphyrin with madam, sir.
All right. Then.
Not get this. I am working on porphyrin, sir. I wrote
a
project on porphyrin.
So you, but you are not taking advantage of that acquaintance.
I agree, sir.
Okay, Prakash Reddy.
Yeah. Good evening to all of you. It is my pleasure to present a vote of thanks. So, ma'am, I would like to thank you for your enlightening talk and sharing your knowledge with all of us, especially our new budding faculty and then research scholars, the PhD scholars.
Prakash Reddy, just tell about yourself.
I was about to ask which year he joined. I didn't remember him.
I did my PhD from NCL. I joined in 2002 and then finished in 2007.
With whom?
With Professor Dr. Pedireddy, who is in IIT.
Pedireddy, I knew. Yeah.
So I know you at least since that time, madam, actually.
Yeah.
So today. So many of us, we do in solid state chemistry and inorganic, and we know all of your name from ICT. And the talk also provided us deep insights and also revealed some of the interesting facts on how to integrate society and science and society. So the precious knowledge that you shared with us will be helpful to all of us in this newly established university. So, ma'am, once again, on behalf of all the participants of the webinar and the Industrial University, I thank you for your time and taking out, giving us your time from your busy schedule. So many of us know you since a long time. And then we all would like to see you in our campus soon. So once again, thank you for your wonderful talk.
Thank you. Arthur,
madam, you want to say something?
Thank you. Nothing.
No, I'm asking
Bharti. Because I am just waiting to see your university and to come there. That's all.
Madam, unmute. Bharti, madam, unmute yourself.
No,
I'm asking Bharti. Bharti.
Sorry, madam, you're most welcome.
Yeah, definitely, madam.
When situation
I was thinking, because Before Dr. Yadav came, I used to visit every month. Now after he came there, now I didn't come. That's why I was feeling very bad. Yeah.
When situation normalizes, you'll be the first person to visit.
Yeah, yeah, definitely, definitely. There is no invitation. I don't need any invitation. I will just come like that. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for accepting our invitation.
Thank you.
I don't know. I got lost somewhere in this.
Sir, after this meeting, you call me. I have to tell an important news to you.
Okay, sure. I'll call.
So with this here, I would like to say our webinar is completed. Thank you for joining.
Thank you,
madam, once again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Bye.